What a wonderful time to be talking about the digital public infrastructure. I mean, India really stands, as many people here would attest to, at a cusp of what is a technological revolution, because technology is not just redefining industries that we constantly hear about, but it is, you know, reshaping the way a nation can aspire to be a global leader, in our case, Viksit Bharat by 2047. With that, let me welcome again all of our panelists and some of the people here who made digital public infrastructure a reality, a possibility, are making great strides in AI, taking really, India's technological powers to the world. Mr. Amit Agarwal, let me start with you about, you know, we've seen the Aadhaar develop over the years. We've, of course, seen UPI. We're seeing ONDC to my right as some of the key architects of the DPI. But start by telling us, to set the context, what you believe have been some of the most transformative steps, as far as the architecture for DPI and artificial intelligence in India is concerned.
Thank you, Ritu. And DPI course, is now common usage, but back then the term was not there, and there was only an idea, and the idea was a unique ID, and the term came much later. And I keep in UIDI, I find my team also using the term foundational ID, and I realize that there is precious little understanding of what exactly a foundational ID means. And then basically a foundational ID is one ID for every citizen and one ID for every use case. And therefore, it is inherently minimal, inherently limited. And how do you design something like that, which will work for everything, but at the same time, not be customized for everything? And then, of course, it's also privacy preserving and other things. So yeah, architecture, as you mentioned, the design and the architecture is the heart of it. And one basic thing about the topic, as I was reflecting on the background note you'd shared with all of us at the panel, and maybe for those in the audience, that yes, it's true that both DPI and AI are factors of production, and in their impact, they can increase productivity, efficiency, all of those things. But in one fundamental way, they are different. And they are different by design, in the sense that DPI was always intended to be inclusive. DPI was India's unique way, the Indian state's unique and consistent way of saying that instead of digital divide, I shall have a policy stance where I will ensure that the benefits accrue equally to all. So it was population scale, it was inclusive. Now here is, once that is a technology, for what does it mean for businesses? What it means for businesses is whatever fruits will accrue out of a DPI will be equally available. If Dilip is and his team are doing something in NPCI, they will worry about making sure every bank benefits, every NBFC benefits, every payment aggregator benefits. AI is not the same. AI is potentially disruptive. On the one hand, it's on the deposit side, it can be hyper-personalization. On the credit side, if you create a underwriting engine which gives you a huge competitive edge, a business entity that onboards it and a business entity that does not, there could be disruptive effects, and that is something people need to consider. For those of us who are in the policy game of trying to ensure an equal level playing field for all, inclusivity at scale, yes. As individual anchors of DPI, so in UIDI, our team, and Dilip's team in NPCI and elsewhere, they are trying to onboard AI onto systems so that the benefits accrue equally to all. For the larger ecosystem, government has got the India AI mission, the seventh pillar thing, which is open not just to government entities, equally to individual banks and everybody. It too has everything to offer. But at the end of the day, individual business entities will have to make investment choices. And that is my key takeaway for all of you.
Well, I'll then toss it over to Mr. Dilip Aspe there. What to your mind has been the most transformative impact of DPI as someone who's built UPI, the hero of India's payment story, now going global?
So first of all, thanks SBI to invite me on this panel. The DPI, Ritu, while we call it, as Amitji said, that, you know, the DPI is a new term, and, you know, the term which has India has given back to the world of a new model of business transformation in that sense, and the democratization of the technology, making it available back to everybody. The evolution has been really fascinating. You know, the way I look at it, you know, it started back with Aadhaar since 2009, and then NPCI looked at some of the platforms like UPI and and Bharat Bill Pay and the IMPS and other platforms. I think the whole journey has been an evolution, right? The when UPI was started 2016 and UPI right now is fairly different. And you know, at least from an NPCI standpoint, NPCI banks, fintechs work together to create a vibrant ecosystem. And under the guidance of the RBI and the government, we have been able to evolve. I think that's a great story till now. Goes without saying that now the AI battle worries and it has a positive and the negative impact both. It's not that India has not seen the technology battles. India has seen large technology battles, moving back from proprietary hardware to the open hardware, proprietary software to the open source software. But I think this AI battle is a little bit more, different than what we have seen before.
300 million unique users and counting.
400 million.
400
yeah.
Now. 400 million unique users of UPI. But let's talk about ONDC. Now you have, what, 14 million transactions as of October, which is a 200% jump from the same period last year. You know, how many sellers and service providers do you now have registered on the platform? And just for the benefit of the audience, very briefly, let's say I'm a small retailer, a seller, who's on the ONDC network. What are the services that I can avail of today? What is the sort of transformative power that the DPI of ONDC brings in my life?
Thank you. Among all the people sitting here, I'm the youngest kid in town. Not by age, but by heading the youngest DPI that India has produced. You know, compared to... we just started, as you said, last year. And we made it available to the public at large in Bangalore City only in 2023, January. And last year, this time, we did 4 million transactions. This year, we did 14 million transactions. So it is 3.5 times growth, but still, we are very, very small. What is the idea of ONDC? I mean, we're building on what Aadhaar at giving an ID to everybody. UPI made payment smooth. Now, what are we saying? That we are making commerce democratic. So if I just simply say the commerce have grown anywhere in the world is that they become walled gardens, which means that it is at the best interest of the shareholders of few companies who are maximizing their interest, whether by creating what we call the walled garden. If I give an example for physical infrastructure, when East India Company was here, they set up the first rail track, but that they meant to maximize their interest. It was not a public infrastructure. When India became independent, we said, hey, this has to be a public infrastructure on which we need to let the business and the citizen build on it and change the country. So that's exactly what we are doing by ONDC here, is that we are creating the digital roads and rails so that it becomes inclusive both on the sell side and the buy side. If you look at the digital commerce, I'm sitting here, all of us are heavy users. But what's the penetration? Less than 10%. On the buy side. On the sell side, 4-5%. And that too, in each domain, you have some behemoths and becoming bigger and bigger. So the open protocol, which helps you to unbundle, gives everybody an opportunity to be there, represented in the market on its own merit, without being restricted with respect to market access, credit, information access, everything being subservient to the intermediary. So that's the whole idea.
Deep, let me come to you, because we've heard what's happened as far as the digital identity is concerned. We've heard what's happened in payments and, of course, what's happening in commerce. But what, to your mind, is the next frontier for DPI adoption in India? Where are you seeing some of the technological forces take shape?
Thanks. Firstly, thanks a lot to SBI for the invitation. What we would see is, I think India is by far possibly the data richest country in the world right now. And it's not about the data, the ease of access of data. I think India is way ahead of a lot of developed countries. So if you look at it from a data perspective, we are actually quite viksit. What would happen is not something new. What we would see is basically the groundwork that has been formed by ONDC, Aadhaar, and other DPI infrastructure. They will come together and there will be higher convergence. And The incremental benefit that would come is, see, all of these data sources are now people are using the data in a quite a raw form and are taking quite basic decisions. Now, as the systems mature and as more data gets aggregated, you would actually see more and more strategic and tactical decisions being taken on this, and that is what is going to give a lift. So the ground is set. The initial results are very, very encouraging. Now we would like to see data being extracted, converted into information being converted to knowledge, and we are being able to decide, say, things like who to give an insurance, who to give a loan, and a whole host of other things. It's not that we need something new from this on. We need to more fully leverage what we have and get it ingrained within the organizations.
Quietly sitting there is the largest fintech in the country, probably within the largest bank. Tell us, to your mind, what has been the most transformative impact of the digital public infrastructure that has been built in the country, and how, as a 218-year-old young bank, as Mr. Sethi put it, is it changing the way you deliver financial services to the last mile customer?
No, thank you for that, Ritu. I think it's not just us, but the entire industry has transformed itself, transformed the way we deliver to our customers. The basic things that we would do as a bank, starting with opening a deposit account, a savings account, to giving a loan, to better underwriting, to making sure that payments, flow seamlessly. I think banking has been by far the largest user of DPI. And in that sense, I think we have not just kept those benefits to ourselves, we've just taken them to our customers. And I think it's just completely turned the business on its head, and the way we do business today is, I don't think we could have imagined that 15 years ago, that this is how we would go about doing banking as a business. And today we are in a position that today we can create services out of everything that we do, and then start building and creating networks and ecosystems. And then you layer on top of that things like artificial intelligence. I think the delivery to our customers, to the rest of the stakeholders that the banking community deals with, I think it's just getting more and more enriched. And there is still, I would say, we've not even covered 10% of the runway. There is still so much to go on the runway, and then as we take off, there will be so much more to climb up to.
Well, since you're still on the runway, tell us what you're building as you take off. What are some of the products in AI, for instance, that we'll see from Yono, from SBI? Because a lot of the banks that are talking about AI, at least generative AI adoption, which is the talk of town these days, are merely talking about chat box, customer service, those kind of uses. What are you building at Yono?
See, we have so far used AI as a back-end service to improve our intelligence, to detect frauds, to create patterns of recognition, to deliver better outcomes for our customers, but through a gate in between. So somebody decides on a set of rules, and the AI model will tell you that this is what you need to do, and it goes through a set of gates, a lot of ethical considerations, etc., governance, and then finally it is delivered as an outcome which can be consumed by either our staff or by customers, maybe not so much directly. Now what we're trying to do is, with GenAI, for the last 1 year or so, we've been developing more knowledge-based interfaces, which is probably the most commonly used, derived use case of GenAI. But what we are seeing now, and that is something that we are taking a lot of keen interest in, is this: how do we build this as a full stack in the organization? Because what's really happening now is that GenAI itself is moving to, or AI for that matter, is now moving to what is being now called as the third wave, which is the whole agentic AI, that AIs start to become semi-autonomous and they start behaving like an agent of the user and they start to perform.
Well, there's lots brimming there, but Yash, let me quickly bring you in as well. As somebody who's, really building for Bharat, tell us whether, business itself would have looked so different had it not been for UPI, for Aadhaar, and perhaps, some of the other DPI in the country. And what is this technology enabling you to do? What would have been impossible without?
First of all, thanks to SBI for having me here and inviting me on the panel. It's absolutely great to be here. And absolutely correct what you said, that Without DPI and the relevant interfaces built around that, I don't think that a business like ours would have been possible today. I was in the US around 10 years ago trying to see if we can do the same business that we do here in India right now, and I realized pretty much that that's just practically not possible for not just the lack of the relevant digital infrastructure, but also a host of other reasons as well. So just for context, what we're really doing is that the question we're trying to answer is that for customers typically who do not get service for credit, insurance, and to a certain degree for investments in the back of the beyond tier two and lower demographics, can we really use data at generated via digital interfaces and digital footprints generated by these interfaces at large scale to do pattern recognition, create alternative credit scores, and actually extend people credit that might come at fairly affordable rates of interest compared to what these people would be typically borrowing at, which would be your typical money lenders who would informally lend at northwards of 10% a month, and obviously make these folks go into a debt trap. Now, fundamentally, if you think about the entire proposition, the way we look at it is that there is DPI, there's a platform layer on top of it, which are public and private platforms consuming these services and allowing customers to access them at scale. And then there are AI layers on top of that, which you build, essentially to be able to figure out that can digital footprint generated via these DPI platforms, as well as the access to services provided by these, could be democratized and made possible to be used for customers at scale. Just to give context, 2 years ago, we tried and we built out a journey where we said that can customers essentially access credit on WhatsApp? Can we go to the reason why we did WhatsApp was because that's probably the most globally or locally relevant platform used by almost everybody out there. And we said that, okay, if people are not using any other platform, can we at least deliver credit via WhatsApp? And obviously a fairly critical component was the ease of access of a CKYC or a DigiLocker that comes in, the ease of the fact that you can deliver credit via UPI, also verify somebody's bank account using that, and then make sure the credit is transferred into the customer's bank account within 5 minutes with all KYC and all the other fraud guardrails also being followed. So I think that, and obviously then you use our own models that we've built over the last 5 to 6 years to be able to credit profile customers, because at that minimal interface that you had in those 20-25 seconds that you take to underwrite, it is not possible to go via the traditional means of evaluating customers by looking at a whole bunch of documents, but by making sure that you are able to do blazing fast credit decisions by using models that are able to consume the data that you take and generate results on top of that. And the one last thing I'd add is that yes, AI on top of DPI is very, very nascent. I think there's, as everybody pointed out, there's a long way to go. The other important question that needs to be answered, which becomes a part of public discourse, is really data privacy and how much customers are comfortable giving access to data.
Sumit, as one of the biggest, I would say, beneficiaries from a business point of view of the DPI that is sitting on our right side, the UPI guardrails that you've built your business on, tell us how you're using AI to further that and what innovations you've built on top of this DPI and what more you'd like to see. I know the regulators on the panel, but from a business point of view, what would make it easier for you to grow?
Thank you, Ritu. First of all, I'd like to thank the SBI for inviting me here. DPI really has transformed right now the nation, right? Take it from UPI, Aadhaar, now with ONDC, VKYC, and it is completely transforming how people transact, how people do business, how identity is managed and verified. I was reading this interesting report by the G20 that said the transformation that India is going through on financial inclusion without DPI would have taken almost 47 years, what it's taken only 6 years. So we clearly are seeing a huge, huge impact of DPI. Now, similarly, AI, I feel, can add another layer on top of it and build more transformations that can produce a step change that we see currently today just starting to happen. GPay, for example, we started with transactions. Now we have enabled transactions first P2P or from people to people, now people to merchants, and now taking a step forward to introduce financial services on top of it. Now with the access and of interfaces and the data points and digital footprints that are available, it enables anyone, like Yash was talking about it, to build credit profiles, to understand users so much better than before. The formal credit reports for most of the Indians is not available. Like most of the Indians have not taken a credit before, hence they have no entry on a credit report. Like only 16% or 18% of the people have credit reports. Now, so how does most of the people access credit? I will go to my friend, I'll go to my relative, ask for credit, or worst case, I'll go to a money shop, loan provider, and get like a really start falling into debt traps. And this is where access to this data really helps, where you could start enabling services on top of it. And this is where AI can use these data points, start understanding user better, start understanding the risk profiles of the user better, and go from there to enable financial services.
Is GPay doing something on that front? Because we know you as a pure play payments company.
We are just starting it out. We are just starting on that.
Mr. Azbe, let me also ask you about, taking India's technology global. We've seen you sign agreements via NPCI International with a whole number of countries to adopt UPI, but of course the process takes time. It won't happen in a matter of months. How many countries have you partnered with now in total? How many more do you hope to partner with? Will this trend continue?
So as far as the RuPay is concerned, the implementation of the RuPay stack is happening in two countries. One is UAE and second is Mauritius. The second is UPI. And UPI, again, we have signed up three countries. The implementation is yet to start. It might start in next few weeks' time. The Namibia, Peru and Trinidad and Tobago is the three commercial agreements have been signed. So total five countries where we are looking at deploying the stack. There are many countries where cross-border transactions has been initiated, which is both merchant payments and while Singapore has been live, there are discussion is in progress in a couple of more countries on the remittance piece. So I think there is a lot of work on one hand as far as the globalization of the stack is concerned.
Okay, could you give us a sense of how many more countries we may see?
There are so many countries. The discussion is in progress, Ritu, but I think it takes time to sign up. I think 5-6 countries have signed up and another 10 countries are in discussion.
All right. Mr. Amit Agarwal, as the cornerstone of DPI again in India, what are some of the biggest lessons you think we can learn, from nations outside as far as DPI is concerned? And what are the biggest benefits that we can sort of transfer to other countries, apart, of course, from UPI, which we're seeing truly go global?
Do you mind repeating the first part of the question?
What are some of the biggest lessons, as far as developing our own digital public infrastructure is concerned, that we can learn from other countries?
We can learn from other countries, okay. So actually, quite frankly, not too much comes to mind. Yeah? But which country? You tell me.
Well, certainly not some of the biggest developed countries that don't have real-time payments so far. But in your experience, is there something India can learn?
As I said, DPI is something almost uniquely Indian because it's a policy. It represents the policy approach to building rails for inclusion for at population scale for everybody. So there should be no digital divide. Most countries left it to the markets to deal with this on its own, and it did not work. There was a conscious policy choice in a very consistent manner and over time to ensure that this is there. No other country has really made that kind of commitment and stayed with that commitment across the years. So really speaking, there are no parallels out there.